So in this video, we're going to look at constant, coefficient, homogeneous, second-order ODEs. So by constant, coefficient, these are like constants. They're not like functions. They're like numbers like, you know, like 5 or square root of 3 over 5 or, you know, 1 over e to the pi or whatever, something like that. Okay, so they're actual numbers, but they're not functions. So they can't have any x's or y's in them. Now, before we can actually do that, we need to do a quick aside just to make sure you remember something. So there's this like little math thing that says e to the theta I is equal to cosine theta plus I sine theta. Okay, if you remember that, great. If you don't remember that, then we've got more to go, but I'll just pretend that you remember that. So now if I plugged in a negative theta I, then that would mean I have cosine of negative theta plus I times sine of negative theta. Come on. Sine negative theta. Cosine of negative theta is cosine of theta because it's an even function. And then sine is an odd function, so it's minus sine theta like that. Beautiful? Okay, fantastic. So here's the thing, is let's pretend that for absolutely no reason at all that I wanted to do this, is just to make a linear combination of the two. So we're just going to follow the math through. So I have cosine theta plus I sine theta, and then B cosine theta minus I sine theta, like that. And as I'm going through here, if I put the cosines together, I would have cosine theta, well, let's put it in front. So I have A plus B cosine theta plus A, I don't know, I minus B I sine theta. So basically, I have this arbitrary constant, and instead of having arbitrary constant A and B, what I can do is I can say, well, I'm just going to make them arbitrary constants, some other arbitrary constants that are just in the same format. So maybe C1 cosine theta and C2 sine theta. And you're like, but wait a second, this guy's had I's in it. Don't the I's matter? And it's like, no, not really, because they're just arbitrary coefficients. So instead of, you know, maybe I get that C2 is equal to 6, whereas before I would have had that A was equal to, I don't know, like 10 over I, and B was equal to 4 over I. So if I'd multiplied them by I and subtraction, I still would have gotten 6. So they're still just arbitrary constants. It's just a little bit easier. So here in a minute, I'm going to go blah, so clearly blah, and you're going to be like, wait, and I'll say, like, remember I talked about that a second ago, and you'll be like, oh yeah, okay. So that's what we're going to do. That's an aside. Now back to real stuff. So we have this lovely constant coefficient, homogeneous, second order, ordinary, differential equation. And we are going to guess a solution of y equals e to the r x, like that. So the idea was that I could say, okay, well, y prime would be r e to the r x, and y double prime would be r squared e to the rx, and that would be kind of cool. So I can go through here, and wherever I see the y double prime, I can put that. Where I see the y prime, I can put that. And where I see the y, I can put that. And so I have a times this r squared e to the rx, and then I have plus b times r e to the rx, and then plus c, e to the rx, equals 0, like that. So I have, if I pull the e to the rx out, I have a r squared plus r plus c equals 0. Now, I know that e to the rx can never be 0, ever, because I can't have, like, a number and raise it, like, I can't have a non-zero number and raise it to a power and never come up with 0. If I raise it to a negative infinity, it kind of approaches 0, but it's never actually going to be equal to 0, which means that since it's non-zero, I can divide both sides by e to the rx, and I don't lose anything of value. I just have this thing right here, ar squared plus r. Oh, I'm sorry, I lost my b. There we go. You're probably wondering what's going on, and I thought it looked a little lonely. Plus br plus c equals 0. Now, this is really special. This is called the characteristic equation. So the idea is that if you give me a constant coefficient homogeneous equation, that the guess that I make, I'm going to make this guess, and it's always going to be a good guess because it's always going to work, that no matter what I do, I'm going to end up with this characteristic equation. So assuming I end up with this characteristic equation, you should also recognize this is a quadratic equation. So it is quadratic. So that means I can use the quadratic formula so that r is going to be equal to negative b plus or minus square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a. If you remember anything from college algebra, you know that this thing right here underneath is called a discriminant. And the idea is if that discriminant is positive, negative, or zero, you end up with different kinds of answers. So since this is a second degree polynomial, I should have two answers. Always I will have two answers. It just depends on what they're going to look like. So basically there's three options. Is the discriminant b squared minus 4ac can be greater than zero? In the case that it's greater than zero, so let me write in here, three things can happen. So if it's greater than zero, that would be like having, some number. I am bad at numbers. 3 plus or minus 5 over 2, like that. So that means my options would be 8 over 2, or what's 3 minus 5? Negative 2 over 2. So 4 or 1, or negative 1. So my options could be 4 or negative 1. If you're curious, that would look like something like this. 4 or negative 1, so those would be my two zeros if I graphed it out. Okay, so that's one thing that can happen. So the official college algebra way of saying this is to say that you have two real solutions. Okay, and they're real because they're not imaginary, and there's two of them because there's two distinct real solutions. Maybe sometimes in college algebra you'd say two distinct real solutions. But basically the idea is if I have two distinct real solutions, remember this was kind of a long time ago, but I guess e to the rx, and we talked about that if I have, so basically in this situation, it'd be like, okay, well, one solution would be e to the 4x, and another solution would be e to the minus x. But since we've talked about this too, maybe is that the solution is a linear combination of those two solutions. So in fact, I'm going to erase these because we're never ever going to do it like that again. We're just going to come straight up and say that if I have two distinct real solutions, if that discriminant is greater than zero, then I have y is equal to c1 e to the 4x, and then c2 e to the negative x would be my two options. So that's the first thing that can happen. Second thing that could happen is that I could have b squared minus 4ac being equal to zero. So I could have 3 plus or minus 0 over 1. So I have 3, and we call that with a multiplicity of 2. So basically, I have the number 3 twice, so it might look like that. So it's over here right at 3. So instead of being at negative 1 and 4, it's right there at 3. Okay, kind of makes sense. So we call this one repeated solution, real solution. All right, and in this case, we have two solutions, but they're the same thing, so we would have e to the 3, or y is equal to e to the 3x, and y is equal to e to the 3x, but that just looks weird, because if I just tried to do that linear combination thing, then I would just say, well, I could just make it a plus b e to the 3x, and then it'd just be really just some other constant, e to the 3x, so where's the other solution? Now, I'm going to show you in a minute why that's true, but for the moment, if you'll just for the sake of simplicity, just believe me, the general form of that is going to be c1 e to the 3x plus c2x e to the 3x, okay? So I'll come back in a minute and kind of show you an example of why it ends up being that way, but for the moment, it's just probably a little easier for you to say, absolutely, whatever you say, I always believe you. You've never led me astray before. Okay, so that's good. All right, the last thing that can happen is you could have b squared minus 4ac is less than zero. So I don't know, you'd end up with something that looks kind of like, say 3 plus or minus the square root of negative 9, or we'll make it negative 16 over 1. We'll just leave it over 1. Now, whenever you work this out, you would end up with 3 plus or minus 4i, like that. Now, I don't know exactly what that particular thing would look out to be, but it would basically look like a parabola that had no intersections, but was kind of somewhere off that didn't actually intersect the real number line right there. So this is called two complex solutions. And it's complex because it has a real part, the 3, and an imaginary part, which is the 4. Okay? Now, so remember we said earlier that there was going to be something that you need to know later? That's now. So we have the two solutions. They look like e to the 3 plus 4i times x, and then e to the 3 minus 4i times x, which means you have a e to the 3 e to the 4ix plus b e to the 3 e to the minus 4ix, like that. So basically we have some kind of, instead of calling this, now this is just a constant times some other constant, so we'll just call it a, it's just still a, e to the 4ix plus b e to the negative 4ix, and we'll go ahead and put the 3 out front because that'll make it, I want that 3 actually, because it's part of the solution, so we'll pull the 3 out there. Okay, there we go. Oh, because it's ex, no wonder that looked weird, 3x, it's like that shouldn't happen. It doesn't. There we go. 3x. All right. And then we have a e to the 4ix plus b e to the negative 4ix. That looks so much better. And if we came up here, we had this little aside thingy that basically said if we had a e to the blah plus e to the negative blah, that it would come out to be sine plus cosine of the blah. And so what we end up here with is we have a solution that's e to the 3x times c1 cosine 4x, and then c2 times the sine of 4x. So basically the idea is that if we have 3 possible things that can happen with that quadratic equation, then that means that we have 3 types of formats of the solution. And those formats are, if we have 2 real solutions, then we have just the e part plus the other e part. If we have 1 repeated solution, we have the e part, but then we have the extra plus x on in there, like right there, that extra x. I'm going to show you that in a minute, okay? And then if we have the complex solution, I can't see this, but if we have the complex solution, then we end up with e to the real thing times a linear combination of sines and cosines of the imaginary part. Okay, so let me show you where that extra x comes from. Okay, so that extra x, let's just use kind of a straightforward-ish example. So say I had, say I had the y double prime minus 6y prime plus 9y. Now, I should be able to read the characteristic equation off of this pretty straightforward. It's the a coefficient, which is 1, r squared, b coefficient, which is negative 6, r, and then plus 9. Okay, so I know enough about math to be able to do that, which means that I have r, which is 3, repeated, with a multiplicity of 2. Okay, so let's pretend I didn't know that it was supposed to be the thingy with the extra x in the second term. So I'm just going to say that I know one solution, and that solution is e to the 3x. Now, I can say I can guess at a second solution, and that's going to be u e to the 3x. Okay, so that means that if this is the second solution, then I can do u2 prime, which would be u prime e to the 3x plus u, or 3u e to the x, come on. And then y2 double prime would be u prime e, or u double prime e to the 3x plus 3u prime e to the 3x. So that's that one chain ruled. This is the first one chain ruled. And then the second one chain ruled is 3u prime e to the 3x and 6u e to the 3x. So that's the second part chain ruled. And if I go through this, then if I plug those into the actual equation, and I can't see it all, if I plug that into the actual equation, then I have y double prime, which is u double prime e to the 3x plus 6u prime e to the 3x plus 6u e to the 3x. So that's y double prime. So I'm going to erase these so that I can, not that part, this part. So there's my y prime is right here. And then I have minus 6 times, that's y double prime, this is y prime. So this is going to be u prime e to the 3x plus 3u e to the 3x. And then plus 9 times y, which is u e to the 3x, and that equals 0. Okay. So obviously I can pull an e to the 3x out. U double prime plus 6u prime plus 6u minus 6u prime minus 18u, minus 18u plus 9u, I think. And that has to equal 0. Now, I can get rid of this because that's not equal to 0, so I can divide both sides by e to the 3x and get rid of that. Combining like terms on the inside is u double prime plus, let's see, the 6u prime minus 6u prime, and then 6u, and then that. Am I not good at math? These really need to cancel out. What did I do funny? Oh, I am so sorry. This is not 6. 3 times 3 is in fact 9, not 6. Who knew? Okay, now those cancel out. So I end up with u double prime is equal to 0. So that means that u prime is equal to some constant, and u is equal to some constant x plus another constant. Like that. And you say, well, how come the other thing isn't x plus a constant? So let's go ahead. So we have that y2 is equal to u times y1, and that y in general is equal to some unknown constant e to the 3x times the first one plus some unknown constant times y2. So y2 is c1x plus c2. Like that. Now if I combine like terms, I've got a plus bc2 e to the 3x plus bc1x e to the 3x. And quite frankly, this is still just a dirty rotten constant. C, 1, e to the 3x. And then again here, this is just some other dirty rotten constant, c2, x e to the 3x. So this is basically where the extra x comes from. This is going to happen every time. If you go through this proof or this example, and you replace all the 3s with r's, this is not dependent upon this being 3. It just, every time you do it, no matter what, these are, it looks worse with algebra. I think if I actually show you the algebra version, you're just going to get so lost in the algebra, you're going to forget what's going on. But just to kind of take a look at this, remember we had this repeated root. So we knew we had one. We guessed the second one. And then we kind of followed through with what we've been doing for quite a while in DiffyQ, is just substituting in, plugging and chugging and seeing where it's going. And as we came through, we were able to find u. And as we found u, we realized that u is pretty much what we had before, just with an extra x. So that's where that comes from, really, is that in general, you are going to end up with, if you have a repeated root, that just means you list it twice, but the second time you list it with an x, so that you can differentiate, so that you can show you've got this different thing.